Live from West Hollywood, it's my Weho World.
Live from West Hollywood.
Live from West Hollywood. Wow.
Good evening,
first day of fall today, everybody.
Is it? Happy fall?
It's finally happened. Autumn. My very special guest, Mr. Christopher Ciccone.
Welcome, Christopher.
Is here today. Christopher, this was a work
in progress. It was a work in progress.
Yeah, here. Sorry. Several months we planned. I went to Europe. You went to, I don't know where you went.
I went to Michigan.
You went to Michigan.
I went to see my parents.
You went to see your parents. How's your dad doing?
He's good. I went to my grandmother's 99th birthday.
She's still with us. God bless her.
How's she doing?
God bless her.
She's good.
Yeah.
She's good.
99.
She's good.
She's mobile? Still,
she's barely mobile. She can't really see, but she remembers things I can't remember.
They can remember what they did 50 years ago, but they can't remember having for breakfast.
She's all there.
Now, does she live with your dad?
No, she lives by herself.
She lives by herself. God bless her. Honest to God, that's incredible. There's longevity in your family. So you and your sister is going to be around for a long time, and all your family, right?
God, I hadn't really thought about that, but yeah.
That's incredible. That is really.
It is amazing, and hopefully she'll make it to 100.
Well, we all know your dad from coming on at the end of during the middle of your sister's concerts.
Blonde Ambition.
If anybody doesn't know, Christopher Ciccone is Madonna's brother, and we're here to talk about other things. Chris does other things, but we know your dad from Kobe's coming out, and it was just always so heartwarming to see. You know, how old is your dad?
He is about to turn 80.
So he's like all of our parents' age. Yeah. And how's his health?
It's good.
Good?
He's good. It's good. It's, you know, he's running a winery.
Wow.
That's what he does.
I always get yelled at for drinking wine all day.
Where in Michigan are
you? It's in just outside of a town called Traverse City. There's about 8 or 10 fairly large vineyards up there. That's a winery. It's not the fantasy I have in my head of what a winery is. Because every time I think about wineries, you know, you think.
He bottles and labels his own wine?
Yeah, it's all estate produced and, you know, crushed on the property. And
can I go online and get it?
Ciccone Vineyards.
Wow.
And CicconeWineryandVineyards.com.
That's wonderful. Well, God bless him. That's incredible. Well, let's talk about you a little bit. I met you. You've been doing some new artwork.
I have.
I found you at the DAP Gallery. On Pico Boulevard of all places. Well, I went in and a friend of mine called me up and said, "Come on down, Christopher Ciccone." And you know when you get these phone calls, okay, I want to buy a piece. And you don't know what to expect, and you showed up that day, and wow. So let's tell us about the medium that you work in. Tell me about the paper again that you work
in. Well, first of all, the show itself is kind of a bit of a retrospective. It covers sort of my Hollywood period, beginning in, seriously. No, and I moved out here in 94.
94?
I had to get out of New York. I broke up with somebody. It's all on the book, actually.
It's all on the book.
But I only intended to staying here a couple of months. There was no intention of living here.
You got sucked into Hollywood.
16 years later.
Yeah.
But for a period of time, stopped painting and was kind of uninspired. I had been painting since the early 80s in New York. And it took, it was just one particular night where, you know, I...
What was going on that night?
It was late.
It was late.
I was hanging out with this guy.
It was late, yeah.
And you know, we were misbehaving of
Chris,
a sort.
Chris, I have 8 viewers, and 3 of the sets have no sound, so don't worry.
Yeah.
You can say whatever
you're telling
want.
No stories.
Okay.
Like, okay. So
out of turn.
We were hanging around. You know, we were having a good time.
You're having a good time.
And this is 5 years after I'd already been here, and mm-hmm. I just got this bug to paint, and I happened to have some old paints around, but nothing to paint on, no canvas, no paper.
Right.
You know, except for this glassine material.
Glassine, that's the word I was looking for.
Which is used to generally wrap painting.
It's right. So if you were to buy a piece of art, like that's what they would wrap it in.
Yes.
And that's what you had in your apartment then.
Yeah, just I happened to have a big roll of it and pulled it out, ripped off a piece of paper, told him to take his clothes off, and we started painting.
Just like that.
And the rest
and
is history.
Basically, that's how I sort of got back into the feel of painting again, and I had been taking Polaroids over that period of time, and right. I had been doing some other things, but it was really my first venture back into painting after a good 6 years, which was good.
Once it's in you, it's like riding a bike. It's always there. Right?
Well, you hope it is.
You hope it is.
You know, I mean,
it's what we pray for.
You know, you rip the paper off, you mix the paint, you get the paintbrush out, and you're like, okay, what? What the fuck am I doing? but it, you know, I just kind of, you know, unlocked the doors in my head with the help of, you know, some.
You locked the doors to your house.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Right.
And, you know, it became it started a series of paintings, mm-hmm. which you one of
they
which is
great.
the
self portrait. I bought your
self
portrait,
like.
Christian.
Yeah.
Yeah. Really.
Which is, you know.
I can't bring it into my house. I call my insurance company. Actually, they've got to schedule it.
He lives in a tough
That's
neighborhood.
Good news. Sure. It's
no,
what it's we pray for.
No, and I'm glad you bought
well,
that.
So
piece.
Anyhow, like I went to the gallery Thanks. And I filmed some work. I want to show our viewers at home what we're sure. talking about here. Yeah. So let's. Oh, there's the part. That's the one that I proudly own.
That's it.
Christopher Ciccone's self-portrait. Anyhow, let's roll that clip of the DAP gallery of Mr. Ciccone's work.
That would be wonderful.
Take it away.
Olden days, a glimpse of stockings was looked on as something shocking. Now, heaven knows, anything goes. Good authors, too, who once knew better words, now only use four-letter words, writing prose. Anything goes.
Hey, welcome. I'm here. This is Joel Q from My Weho World. I'm at the DAP studio here on Venice and Fairfax, where My Weho World got invited to a special opening of Chris Ciccone. You'll know, you probably remember him. He's Madonna's brother. And we've been lucky enough to be invited on a tour. So let's go. This is Brad Littlefield of the
DAP Studios.
DAP Studios. Yes, I can say that now.
Yes.
How are you?
I'm wonderful. Thank you guys so much for coming in.
Thank
today.
You. Thank you for doing this very special My Weho World production.
Yes.
How long have you had your gallery?
We've been here for about 2 years now.
About 2 years.
Yeah. We've had a number of shows here, Christopher's being the most recent, mm-hmm. most successful.
Now, as you say, Christopher, as in?
Christopher Ciccone.
How do I know that name?
Oh, there's material.
It's Christopher Ciccone. I think yeah. I know that. Where would we hear that before?
Certain material.
A certain material. Okay, it's Madonna's brother.
Yes, right. That's right.
Well, I met Christopher yesterday. Mm-hmm. What a gentleman.
And great guy to
what,
work with.
What a great guy. Okay, what a true gentleman. And here we are in front of his work.
Yes.
There yeah.
So Christopher's a videographer, a choreographer. He's produced, you know, some of the largest productions for Madonna in terms of her world tours.
Uh-huh.
But I think as an artist, he emerged most recently in 2002 with his works on glassine. Glassine is a material used to wrap art for shipping. And
you're joking.
No, seriously.
So Christopher is looking at this glassine and saying he bought a piece of art, obviously, and said, I'm gonna make art out of this.
Well, so the story goes, one night in 2002, he had a young man come back to his apartment. They were talking in the kitchen.
Uh-huh.
And Christopher was overwhelmed by the urge to paint him. And he looked around the apartment. All he had was some glassine. He asked the young guy to take his clothes off and sit in a large 19th century English chair. He threw the glass seat on the floor, he pulled out his paints, and this was the work that actually came from.
And this was yes. came from that night?
Yes. In Christopher's manifesto, which I'm sure he'll talk more about with you uh-huh. guys, this was really the inspirational work that unlocked the creative parts within him that had been dormant right. for so long that he had forgotten about. And so this was the nexus for the creation of these very clean works, which really have qualities, I think, of Chinese paper and ink. You know, the brush strokes are very clean, they're very authentic, they're very honest. It's great work.
So Brad, this my favorite piece behind me is entitled
Self-Portrait.
So this is Christopher's self-portrait of
exactly.
himself.
His interpretation.
This is his interpretation of what
on glassine.
Exactly. The medium for this is the same as
acrylic on glassine.
On glassine is the wrapping paper.
Right. It's like wax paper, similar substance. And you know, it's interesting. Christopher pioneered this in about 2002, and it's really exploded as a way of presenting different artworks. So many people have adopted this.
There's no limitations to art, is mm-hmm. there? There's no limitations. Oh, all right. Well, let's moving on. So the piece behind me here is
Me.
Not me.
Right.
Not you.
Not me.
Not you. Not me.
Not me.
But not me.
I wish it was me.
So who is it?
I can't say. I'm not at liberty to disclose that. I did tell you, I'd have to kill you.
That's confidential information.
Right.
All right. Okay. Well, Brad, this title here is called
Blue Boy.
This is, I think, one of my favorites.
I think you and I both share.
As I went through the gallery yesterday and then coming back today, this piece is really sticking out here right. a lot. And the significant, is this Christopher as Blue Boy?
No. There's another subject, but what's interesting about this piece, which is acrylic on canvas with pen and ink.
Uh-huh. Acrylic on canvas with pen and ink.
Yes. Or actually ink pen.
Yes. Oh, whatever.
So it's a mixed media piece.
Uh-huh.
And it incorporates his style, the quick, clean brush strokes, mm-hmm. as well as, you know, thought. And you really see a lot of Christopher's expression in it.
It's the colors just really pop out at you
yeah.
at this one.
And I think it's both our favorite pieces. Yeah.
Was this another late night piece?
I think
you
so.
You think so, too.
Yes.
When Christopher titles something, is something particular in his mind, or is this a question for Christopher?
Well, these are all a series of inspirations from late night exploits here in Hollywood.
Late night exploits in Hollywood.
There's definitely a racy quality to it.
Mr. Littlefield, this is the photography. I don't know if my mother's watching,
right.
but his photography gets to kind of like it's on the erotic side.
Well, what attracted me was the tonal and shot quality of this work. And there's actually a series of about 700 Polaroids, all taken from late night exploits. And I think they reveal a great degree of intimacy as well as excitement. This is part of the show that I'm most excited about exhibiting here at the gallery.
This photograph here is one of his late night escapades, obviously.
Right. Yes.
And this happens to be one of my favorites with the photographs. It's a gentleman embracing a painting on a wall.
Yeah.
And what is, do you know the title of this?
Well, it's the signature piece from the gallery. It's number 10. We actually used this on the gallery card for the show.
I can see why.
It captures a lot of the eroticism and energy of the show.
Yeah, it kind of jumps out at you. Mm-hmm. I like that a lot.
Right.
And there's other things popping out there too.
Yes.
So I guess we would stick around and see what comes up, right?
Exactly.
It was absolutely a wonderful tour here. It was such an honor to see Mr. Ciccone.
Well, I loved having
here.
You guys in, and you're always welcome.
Thank you so much. What's coming next to the gallery?
So I've got a really special show we're working on. I'm glad you asked. The iconic gay painter, Delmas Howe, just had an opening in New Mexico, and we're hoping to bring him here in September.
Really?
Yeah, he hasn't shown in Los Angeles since 1990.
Really?
He's best known for his interpretation of leather and cowboy and male nudes.
Oh,
that's
going to be a great show.
It's going to be a good time. We're going to premiere his work as well as
We'll have to come back down. The Truth or Consequences of Delmas Howe.
Yes.
Wow. Well, this was wonderful. Thank you so much. Thanks so much.
Anytime.
So though I'm not a great romancer, I know that I'm bound to answer when you propose.
And we're back. That was great.
Whoa.
Was it nice to see?
That was beautiful.
That was incredible.
You haven't seen that before.
No, and it looks beautiful on camera. I've never seen my paintings
on. You never seen your painting
on camera? On. Moving camera.
A moving camera.
I mean, when I look at them at my computer, they're this big. You know.
Yeah, that's true.
Now, you were just telling us you sold two of your items.
Two of the paint, the Matador, the larger one, and the collection of Polaroids are going to Museum of Contemporary Art in Mexico City.
Congratulations. My investment went up already.
It did indeed.
What can I say?
And now worth more money?
Yeah.
Maybe give me that invoice back.
Give me that. Right. No. Signed, so delivered. It's mine.
Yeah, I did.
Okay. Anyhow, so in the meantime, a couple years ago, as we all know, I have to say, I was sitting in the dentist chair last week. This is the God's honest truth.
Truly?
And I don't mean, and I said, Trish Ciccone's coming on my show. She's a girl from Puerto Rico, doing an intern over here. And of course, she said, that's Madonna's brother, right? And I said, yeah. She goes, they're not talking, right? And I thought, well, we're going to find out.
We'll find out.
All right, you wrote a book.
Now,
she wrote a book, okay, My Life with My Sister.
A memoir.
A memoir. So what's going on? What do you want us to know?
Well,
too big of a cry. Okay, take it from the top.
You went page 150 or
365? Okay, your dad's getting old. You said in an interview that I did my homework, you said at some point, the book was very nice. She got upset about the book. She called your father and said, I want you to choose sides, like be mad at Chris. I'm Italian. I had the same thing in my family.
He already, without realizing it, had chosen sides because he allowed me to use family photos.
Right, exactly. Right.
And it wasn't like he was choosing sides. They're family photos. They didn't belong to her. And they were everybody. And so, you know, she got very upset with him and wasn't speaking to
him. She got upset with your father?
Yes.
Right.
Really?
Instead of just venting it. Well, she was already mad at me.
Okay. She's already mad.
Well, just stayed focused on me. There was no point in dragging my father into it.
That's true.
And he's upset about this now.
How did your father defend himself?
Well, there's nothing to do. He's like, they're fat.
Do you regret it?
I don't regret it at all. And you know, they'll work out a relationship. They've worked their thing out.
Because this is your story.
It is, and it's impossible to tell my story without telling partly her story because they're interconnected.
And you were with her. Now, when she went to New York before she was in, you were with her, correct?
Yeah, I mean,
you were a young boy then.
We were 20. I was 23. She was 25.
Wow. Yeah.
You know, that's when
we
started.
Were you scared to go to New York?
Well, no, I moved there when I was 19,
and
got a job with a Canadian dance company. Uh-huh. Then I left New York, came back when she made her first record. And became a backup dancer for her.
Wow.
And that's how it started. We did the clubs in New York. We did
because
Studio 54.
In the community here, Chris Ciccone's, everyone says, well, if it wasn't for him, you peddling her tapes around to every DJ in New York, we probably would not know Madonna's name.
I'm not going to take total credit for her thing.
You helped. You were there.
I was there from the very beginning.
You were there from the very beginning.
Right. And there was a period when we did club dates like you do when you start out But that changed into, her marrying Sean Penn and moving out here and all that other stuff ensued.
All the drama.
Yeah. But after that period ended, I was on every tour up until the Girly Show.
You did. You designed the set for Blonde Ambition.
I designed the Blonde Ambition, and then I designed and directed the Girly Show.
The Girly Show. Uh-huh.
So, that was.
It fun?
For me, the Girly Show was as Shia LaBeouf would say, the epitome.
The epitome. Yeah.
of my career. Uh-huh. The epitome, and of us working together. I think it was like kind of, we were both. At our peak.
You're at your
peak.
And
it was really, it was a great moment.
And it was a partnership. I mean,
it was. It was very much that, and even more than that,
your family.
Because I was directing it, she took it, she gave me that respect. And, and I said, change this, she would change that. I think, as time went on, though, it just, you get caught up in that person's world so much.
Right.
And I was so completely lost in that.
And it had to be a surrealistic world.
I mean, a big bubble.
She
just kind of surrounded
star
us.
In the world you're dealing with.
Yeah, and then and at some point you have to sort of figure out where you are and what you're doing.
Right.
And
your identity.
Yeah, and what that is, and that kind of when I began to realize those things in me and that I wanted more than this. that I wanted to get back to painting and that I wanted to be, you know, right. an artist and a designer.
Right. You're an artist in your own
not
right.
Not just her brother that traveled around with her. You know. Yeah. I mean, you know, remarkably, every time, even though I was on every tour, it was still an uphill battle with each tour we did. There was 200 crew members and 10 dancers and eight band members, and you know, so it's and you're and
now were you on the Virgin tour as well?
Of course, yeah, I was on all of them.
I remember the two male dancers she had.
Yeah.
I wonder what they look like now. Do you think they can still dance like that?
Well, you know, I've aged, I'm sure, as well as they have, so. So I'm not gonna. I have no idea. I haven't seen them in a thousand years. But
I think that's the only one that I can't get on DVD. Actually, that's only on VHS, which I do have it on VHS. But
I'm sure they'll put it on DVD at some point.
It's
part of a.
I was almost
life's work collection.
I was in San Francisco when she did the next tour, which came out on DVD as Ciao Italia.
Oh yeah.
Okay, and
is that the Cow Palace?
Huh.
Was that at the Cow Palace?
I forget. I don't know, but all I know, I was in San Francisco for business, and I was driving through, and the only way you could get tickets was through scalpers, and the police were right there. And I said to my friend that I was with, my director, Jan Michael Foster, I said, I really flip-flop and want to see Madonna. This is when she was married to Sean Penn, right? Okay, and the cops were like right there.
So did you scalp the tickets?
No, we couldn't, Arthur. It would be
coward.
I don't know who would have went to jail, me or the scalpers. Okay, but to this day, I regret.
It's the scalpers.
Yeah, I think so.
Well, you know, I didn't know. You know, it was just like the police were everywhere. It was just like. So we didn't see that tour. But then it came out on DVD. So.
Why don't you read your viewer mail?
Viewer mail. I
have a question. I think
I have viewer mail for you, Chris. Actually.
Cool. You mean people actually?
Well, I've announced a while, you know.
We announced six times you were coming.
Oh, right.
We announced six times you were coming on, darling. Okay, so
sorry.
I got, here we go. Here's a good one. Dear Joel Q, I know you are planning to have Christopher Ciccone on your show. Would you please ask him for me what he thinks of Lady Gaga? Sign from Gugu for Gaga on Gardner. Also, P.S. Crazy about Madonna too. Well, that's very nice.
Well, I do think something about Lady Gaga.
Okay.
I think you might have.
I think on the whole, she's very talented. She's a good songwriter, great songwriter, a great performer, and she has an amazing voice. My only concern is that, it's not so much a but, it's just, she has so existed in the extreme. That what connects her to people isn't there right now. There's no, for example, when my sister started out.
Right.
Okay.
Which we all remember.
She wore her hair tied up and the rubber bracelets. And I'm not suggesting that Lady Gaga do that and that is a better way, but people could actually make a connection to that, go buy that stuff.
It was a look.
Dress
they all
like
imitated
her.
Right.
You could dress
right.
like
Every
her.
Girl in high school.
Even the boys were dressing like
exactly.
her.
Exactly.
I mean, with Gaga, you can only dress like her on Halloween.
When I was in high school, or right after high school, before your sister, it was Pat Benatar.
Yeah.
All right, there was girls, all right, everyone, the girls that I would work with was dressed like Pat Benatar.
That's
and
right.
then boom, your sister moved in. But like Gaga, right.
Well, she's so far out, she's already stepped so way out there. Mm-hmm. The only place for her to come is back to a real person.
Do you think
that's what she needs to do. She's going to have to do that to survive it.
Do you think 20 years from now we'll look back and she'll still be
around? It depends on what she does in the next two or three years. If she can take a step back and become a real person, take this stuff
off.
That would be my advice
to her.
Right now. That's exactly my advice to her. If I was her manager, I'd be like, "Okay, get out of the crazy shit. Just step back a little bit.
Stop letting
become a little bit more real. Let people connect to you.
Did you see her
not
news
just
release?
Look at you in a sort of in awe?
Right.
I need to make a connection, otherwise it doesn't last.
Did you see her news release on the Don't Ask, Don't Tell with bringing the people that were thrown out of the military for being homosexual? That bringing her up. She almost seemed, when you say she seemed real. Have you seen that recently?
I did see that. I've seen it. I mean, I've seen her comment on a few things. And believe me, when my sister was commenting on things back in the past,
everybody listen.
Well, whatever. I mean, it was just silly crap. She was. I mean, you're sitting there watching. Come on, you're watching David Letterman,
right.
and she's saying shit for.
Now, didn't they have a problem, her and David Letterman?
It's just, it's, she's never done well in interviews like that, ever.
Okay.
It's been, in the years that I've known her, it's just not a good,
it's
just
not
a good venue for her. It's like, just shut up and sing. You know? Shut up and sing. It's when you get, when she get political, it's just like
it's the, out of her. Right, you know, we all have.
Look, she's incredibly smart, but the
your sister's incredibly smart.
But it's performing that she does best.
Is it true she turned down a scholarship to Northwestern University to go to New York? I read that somewhere. Or is that folklore? To,
you mean way back?
Yeah, yeah. That she had a scholarship.
She went to Michigan.
She went to Michigan. She did go. Okay.
Yeah. She didn't go to North. She went to Michigan.
She went to Michigan.
University of Michigan.
Okay. Okay.
And I'm not sure if there was a scholarship, but she was. Yeah. She went to U of M.
Uh huh.
As a, in the dance, in their dance program.
So.
But, yes. For as far as, and look, there are some similarities between her and Gaga, and I see it. And.
Do you think that she's ripping her off?
I don't think. Look. I won't call it rip. I wouldn't call it ripping it
okay.
off. It's.
I mean, the
she's certainly gone beyond whatever Madonna does. I mean, the stuff that we were doing, the stuff that we were trying.
It's pretty out there.
Yeah, but we were. I always looked at ourselves as a bit was more theatrical.
Yeah.
Less right. extreme.
It was.
I mean, we may have been pushing envelopes in certain areas with religion and sexuality.
Right. Yeah.
And those kind of things, but. There was always something that you could sort of connect to as a person, that someone in the audience could sort of grasp onto a little bit, and they knew something in their lives or was part of their lives, and they could get they could feel that.
Exactly,
sort of thing.
Exactly.
Watching Lady Gaga burning some guy in a bed, it just it's like. And I look, I don't have a problem with it. You want to do that to people?
I wanted to do that to some people, but you know.
I don't see the emotional connection between her and her fans.
You know, Chris, right now, I got to say thank you very much for coming on. Because you know what? We're out of time.
Okay.
Chris, God bless you, West Hollywood. Thank you, Christopher.
So you got my Gaga quotes.
Whatever we do, we're going to go through it together. We may not go far, but sure as a star, wherever we are. No fights, no feuds, and no egos. Amigos, together. Through thick and through thin, all out or all in, and whether it's win, place, or show, with you for me and me for you, we'll model through whatever we do together.
I was superimposed. I was an actor.
I'm dancing down the Champs-Élysées, Christopher, and Arthur's superimposed.
Thank you, so much,
thank you very much, Christopher. It was very nice. Thank you for taking the time.
They're great.
Right, what is it? We have 15 seconds. Well, my God, my camera could drop. Thank you very much, Christopher Ciccone. It was absolute. It was an absolute pleasure. Absolute. God bless. There we go. We are out.